Yeah, hi, good evening everyone. My dear young innovators, once again we are in front of you. Before starting this conversation, I just give you some brief background of this is NXP Campus Connect program, and the objective of this program is to share new technologies with you. And as you are aware of, we are running two parallel sessions. One is VLSI, where our experts are sharing the VLSI concepts, deep dive into different technologies. And the other track is the system engineering track. And today we have a system engineering track where our technical experts are going to describe the applications of V2X. When we are saying V2X, it is basically the vehicle to infrastructure communication. This is a very exciting topic, a very latest and very futuristic approach here, and our experts will drive through all this experience, that how V2X is enabled into different cars. It is already deployed, and they will update you what all is this. So before jumping on to that, I will introduce two of our experts, technical experts. One is Dalton is already visible. I don't know why Rajiv is not visible. So Rajiv and Dalton are our experts in the V2X. Yeah, hi Rajiv, you are now visible. A lot of young innovators want to see your face. So welcome Dalton and Rajiv to this NXP Campus Connect program. And I know you have very exciting presentation here, and this application itself is very innovative and futuristic, and it is related to automotive. So yes, excitement is already there, and all our young innovators are on the driving seat. So Rajiv and Dalton are having more than 20 years of experience in this industry. They did lot of innovations and lot of futuristic implementations for not just automotive but all other different applications. So welcome Dalton and Rajiv. My young innovators are waiting for the lecture. I don't want to waste much time here. Before starting the presentation, we'll wait for 2 minutes because we are going to record this session. And if anyone is having concern, please raise your hands. Else we will start this after 2 seconds. So Dalton and Rajiv, stage is yours. Please wait for 2 seconds. And maybe Rahul, if any hand raise, update us. Otherwise, we are presuming that there is no concern raised by any of our attendees.
Okay, Manish.
Thank you, Rahul, for all your support. IT is, always the backbone of any innovation. So yes, Dalton and Rajiv, stage is yours. Please go ahead and interact with our young innovators.
Okay. So thank you very much, Manish, for the kind introduction. And yeah, good afternoon, everyone. It's, I mean, to me, it's a great pleasure to connect to our college students, our campus representatives. It's because, I mean, it's 23 years since I completed my M.Tech. And it's so most of you wouldn't even be born at the time when I completed it. So it's to me, it's more of an intergenerational interaction, and so really excited about it. So coming to my role in NXP, I'm the manager of the software team in Bangalore, who is working on V2X software. Right, we have been working on NXP's V2X product for at least last seven, 8 years, and we have addressed at least different generations of V2X products in NXP. So yeah, in terms of exposure to V2X, yes, we are there, and it's a vast area. So at least whatever we know, we would be very happy to share with you. Right, and I let my colleague Rajiv to introduce himself. Rajiv.
Hi, good morning. So yeah, as Dalton told, we are also in this industry for last almost close to 20 years now. So for me, I've been involved more with multimedia processing than not TV domain. The last few years, it's been this V2X. This has been exciting for us. It's a new area, and since we could have some products out, it's a great feeling and to discuss the same with you all. Thank you.
Yeah. So let me continue. So this is, here you see our plan today, right? First, we start with an introduction to V2X. What is V2X? Why is it there? Right, and the typical applications of V2X. And then we go into the realization of a V2X system, right? We are engineers, we build systems. So what are the critical questions? What are the critical challenges that is there in building a V2X system? Right. So we will. It's a broad area. So, but we will look at some critical topics and what are the critical technologies that's being used in V2X. Then we go to NXP's current solution. It will be a short discussion where we at least get introduced to the NXP's product, so that you at least get a sense of what are the key differentiating or the key elements that needs to be there in this. Elements. Then we go to overall V2X deployment status worldwide. At least whatever information we have, we will share with you to get an overview of where we are with the overall deployment. So I go to why V2X, right? So we have a set of societal challenges that comes from excessive transportation that we have. We have too many vehicles on our road and it's been increasing always, right? It throws out three critical issues. Number one is the safety. So the data shows there is roughly 38,000 people who die on the road in European Union. In US, there are similar numbers. And the economic cost associated with this safety, these accidents, runs into two huge billions, right? And on the other side, we have congestion. I don't know, in a city like Bangalore, where we come from, the congestion is a day-to-day experience. And so worldwide, its economic cost is somehow mapped. And in US, they say it's roughly 87 billions per year is the cost. EU, they have reported 1% of the GDP as the cost of congestion. And then always the amount of time that we waste in our travel, right? That's also, it's really translate to the human cost or the human wastage of our resources and time. Go to environmental costs, there's wasted fuels, right? CO2 emissions, as all of us know, is massive. The climate change implications of these emissions. The dependence on fossil fuels for our day-to-day drive, right? So overall, the excessive transportation is a major cost, is a major cause of concern. So there is always an approach to sense. If the automotive sense its environment, we should be able to reduce the overall cost along associated with the safety issues, the congestion issues, the environmental issues. So now, if you look at the different ways to sense, right? There are many sensors. We have ultrasonic sensors where each of these sensors have its own pros and cons, right? LiDAR gives you a very good resolution images. Radar is much affordable in a lot of cars now. It's excessively getting used, but it has its own limitations. Camera. So along with all this, right, V2X is another way to sense your environment. For a car to know what is happening in its environment, right? So when compared to, we'll come into the detail, I mean, what exactly is V2X, but it gives a broader range, right? 1,000+ meters, you can easily get with the V2X communication. A line of sight limitation, right? If you have a radar or a lidar or whatever, if an object comes between you and your target object, you want to see that object, you don't see because there is a line of sight limitation. The sensing is only if the second object is in a line of sight. So V2X sort of overcomes that. And the disadvantage is it's a communication protocol. It's not sensing actually. Two guys talk to each other. It is cooperation, right? So you really need another person or another car for you to understand what is the environment doing. But eventually, it is a set of these sensors used in judiciously is what is going to give us the right degree of sensing and the right degree of protection. So we go to then what is V2X, right? So V2X is a vehicle to everything. A vehicle tries to communicate with different objects around it. It's a communication between a vehicle and any entity that may affect or may be affected by the vehicle. Right, so it could be anything, but typically now if you look at the real implementations, you have vehicles here. They communicate with each other to meet your whatever functionality that needs to be achieved. So there are onboard units in each of the cars, and then we call as the infrastructure, say for example a traffic light. You could embed a V2X module there to communicate with the car. So these three elements, typically V2X means a V2V, a vehicle-to-vehicle communication, and V2I, vehicle-to-infrastructure communication. So V2X is also known as a cooperative intelligent transport system because it's all about cooperation. It's about two cars talking to each other. And so these cars form an ad hoc network of cars, and they share information, and whereby we achieve some improved degree of safety. A lot of other applications can be built around it. So this USS National Highway Transport Safety Authority, their estimation is roughly 13% traffic accidents can be reduced if we have a good V2V or V2X system. So to reiterate, V2X just means that you have sort of a communication between cars and infrastructure. They are able to tell each other mainly their position, right? With that information, you are able to build certain set of applications that improve the safety. I go to the next slide. So Rahul, could you play the video? Do I have to do something, Rahul, here or?
No, Dalton, just give me a moment.
Okay, sure.
Curvature and lower during lane changes or transitions in and out of curves.
With path history and path prediction, the vehicle is essentially being provided with a dynamic map of the roadway geometry ahead, essential information for performing threat assessment and predicting potential crashes.
It's important to note that information transmitted by every vehicle is anonymous and does not include any personally identifying information such as name or license plate number. And a sophisticated security system has been put in place to ensure that all information exchanged between vehicles is authentic and can be trusted.
By employing common data, security, and communication standards, V2V interoperability among automotive manufacturers has been achieved.
Since all vehicles communicate in the same way, each automotive manufacturer is free to develop their own safety applications and warning indicators.
When a crash is predicted, the vehicle will provide a warning to the driver, either through a seat vibration, tone, or visual display, or combinations of these indicators.
The systems developed under this project are only intended to provide crash warnings. The driver remains in control at all times, and the vehicle will not automatically brake or steer.
The following scenarios demonstrate some of the safety applications that can be enabled using V2V technology. The Emergency Electronic Brake Light Safety Application, or EEBL, can notify a driver of a hard braking vehicle in the path ahead. Three vehicles are traveling in the same lane. You are driving the last vehicle. You can't see the first vehicle because it's being blocked by the vehicle directly in front of you. Unexpectedly, the first vehicle slams on its brakes. Because of V2V communication, your vehicle is able to provide a warning of the hard braking vehicle ahead, well before you see brake lights from the vehicle directly in front of you. This warning will enable you to drive safely and avoid a potential crash.
The Blind Spot Warning Safety Application, or BSW, lets a driver know that there's a vehicle that may not be visible positioned in the driver's blind spot. Because of V2V communication, a blind spot advisory is issued to make you aware of the presence of this vehicle. Should you attempt a lane change with the vehicle still in your blind spot, this advisory will escalate to a warning, letting you know that it is not safe to change lanes.
The Lane Change Warning, or LCW, is a safety application intended to provide a warning if a driver intends to change lanes into a zone that will soon be occupied by a faster moving vehicle traveling in the same direction. Using the data obtained through V2V communication, your vehicle predicts that this vehicle will soon be in this zone. If you attempt to make a lane change, a warning will be provided, letting you know that the lane change should not be attempted.
The Forward Collision Warning Application, or FCW, is intended to warn the driver of a potential rear-end crash with a stopped or slower-moving vehicle ahead. You are driving over a small hill, and ahead in your lane is a slower-moving vehicle. The vehicle ahead is wirelessly sending its information, allowing your vehicle to provide a warning if you are approaching too quickly and/or in a potential rear-end crash situation. This will enable you to slow to a safe speed and distance behind the slower moving vehicle.
Now consider that a vehicle ahead of you has, for example, run out of gas and is stopped in your lane. The vehicle directly in front of you makes a late lane change around the stopped vehicle. Even though you can't see the stopped vehicle, because of V2V communication, your vehicle is aware of the stopped vehicle and provides you with a warning ahead of time, so that you can safely slow your vehicle before reaching the stopped vehicle ahead.
The Do Not Pass Warning, or DNPW, is a safety application intended to let the driver know that it is not safe to attempt to pass a slower moving vehicle because of oncoming traffic in the passing zone. Using V2V communication, your vehicle is continually looking for cars in your intended passing zone. If a vehicle is detected in the passing zone, a driver advisory is provided, letting you know that the passing situation is potentially unsafe. Should you attempt to pass the slower vehicle, the advisory escalates to a warning, so you can stop the attempted maneuver and remain in your lane.
The Intersection Movement Assist, or IMA, is a safety application intended to warn the driver when it is not safe to enter an intersection because of the high likelihood of a crash with a vehicle on an adjacent approach to the same intersection from either the left or the right. If an intersecting vehicle is detected using V2V communication, a driver warning is provided if it is unsafe for you to enter the intersection.
Now, imagine you are approaching an intersection where you have the right of way and cross traffic must stop. As you approach the intersection, the driver of a crossing vehicle fails to stop and continues traveling through the intersection directly in front of you. A warning is provided when the violating cross traffic is detected. This helps you respond in a timely manner and stop rather than continuing through the intersection and potentially getting into a crash.
The left turn assist application is intended to warn the driver.
Yeah, so thanks, Rahul. So we just now saw a series of applications of V2X. If you really look at it, the technology only does give the position of one car, right, to the other, and with that we are building a certain set of applications, which provides a lot of safety stuff. So if you extend a little bit, I mean, it can be used for the pedestrian detections with the help of a roadside unit. It can be used for ambulance to tell others in the road to give way from a distance. We can use a roadside unit to tell cars that some work is going on. So it's all simple. I mean, it's an immense possibilities that's opened with the basic communication that's achieved between the cars and the roadside infrastructure unit. Okay, so there is a whole lot of applications that we are talking about, and so this is a summary of some applications that is there really in one of the cars, right? So there is this stationary slow or stationary vehicle detection. We saw that scenario here. There, I mean, it's a question of the slow vehicle telling the car behind that I'm going slow. I may not be visible to you, so it's not a line of sight scenario. But because of the message goes, the car behind is able to take corrective action. Right, road work warning, weather conditions. There are tons lots of these applications. It's either, typically it's either a car telling about its position and some information about itself, or the roadside unit telling the cars about information about the road condition, whether the road is snowy or icy and you cannot drive on that. That's a type of things. So that's a spectrum of applications that we have with V2X. It has some more details like, I mean, control channel, service channel, that will come to in later slides. But essentially, a lot of safety and non-safety related applications can be built by these very short messages between the cars. So far, what we looked at is, what is V2X? So we discussed V2X just is about vehicles, roadside infrastructure units, communicating with each other, typically telling the position of each other, and we building a certain set of applications around it. We are engineers. Our next question is, how do we build a V2X system? Right. So in the previous slides or previous discussions, the video, what the key characteristics of V2X is this, it extends sensing beyond one's own vehicle. You are not, a radar or some other stuff is purely dependent on your car, right? In V2X, it's cooperative, and it is beyond line of sight. The non-line of sight is a key aspect of V2X, and we build a lot of applications because of this. Now, in an engineering level, a low latency of the messages, right? If a car in front of you breaks, the time it takes for the message to come to you and act is critical. There are certain targets like 50 milliseconds or so, set by, set in some context for this low latency, right? If you have a system where it takes seconds, your AI, it's completely useless. We need some sort of a communication system with a very low latency. The second topic is the security. Now, here we are talking about networks, right? Cars communicating with each other. Cars are sending messages. Now, all the network security issues pop up here. So in terms of an engineering level, low latency and security are the two fundamental issues to be addressed. And to address this, we have modems, certain standards being selected for this purpose, right? So now if we go to the actual system realization, I captured here a very simplified architecture, typical architecture that is deployed in building V2X systems. So always you have a modem, of course, it's a communication device, so you have to send, receive messages, right? You have a hardware security module, right? This is the security related topic where we need a computing device which safeguards all your keys, right? If it's communication, if it is security, you typically use keys for signing or encryption or whatever, and those keys have to be absolutely protected. So we typically need a hardware security module in the system to protect this. These are typically hacker-proof device. Hacker-proof is exaggeration, but if these devices have the intelligence to detect when someone is trying to hack it, some voltage changes or some current variations, etc. These devices can detect, and they will slow the performance or lock the device, etc. So it's a separate stream of study, but so a V2X system typically employ a hardware security module to protect the keys, and then it has a modem, and then there is a security functionality typically implemented in different processes. So going forward, now we will look into the two key aspects. Modem, right? What are the typical topics around it? What is the standards, and what are the typical challenges, or how it reduces the low latency? That's one of the discussion that we are going to have in our how to realize a V2X system. And we will also discuss security related topics. So hand over to you, Rajiv.
Yeah, thank you, Dalton. Yeah. So here, if you see V2X communication, right, there are two competing technologies now. One is called the DSRC, which we have been discussing. It's called dedicated short range communication. It is based on the Wi-Fi standard, which we all know. And this is called, it's a derivative called 802.11p. Yeah, that is the standard, the PHY and the MAC part of it, which is used for communication. And the next generation of it is coming out. It's called NGV, next generation V2X. And this is under 802.11BD. This is coming from the IEEE, yeah. The other competing standard is from the 3GPP, that's cellular based. And there they call it CV2X. So the current one which is available is called LTE V2X, which is based on the 3GPP release 14 and 15. This is the current one. And it's almost similar to our normal LTE communication with some extension to support car-to-car communication. And now they are coming up with a new one called New Radio V2X, which is also 3GPP based. It's release 16. So which will support V2X properly. Here the only issue is in the CV2X, the release 16 is not compatible with release 14 and 15. So if a few cars are there with release 14 or 15, cannot talk to cars which have the early 16 version of the 5N Mac. Yeah. Dalton, the next channel, next slide.
Thank you. Sorry.
Yeah. So here, maybe I will say it from, okay, the standards point of view, right? So this for DSRC specifically, I'm going to discuss only regarding DSRC and more from the US standard point of view, just to have an example, and then that can be spread across other. Similarly, you have for EU and Japan also. So if you see, EU and USA both have a 5.9 gigahertz frequency band for the DSRC. And the frequency allocation is almost, it was like this. Basically, USA had 75 megahertz bandwidth, EU had 30, and Japan had 10. The EU and US, they have similar, that is 802.11p, which is OFDM based. Yeah. And the standardization, if you see the USA, it's called IEEE 1609. They are the set of standards 1609.1-4, which gives defines what needs to be done in each layer. That is, and the phi and MAC is 802.11p. Similarly, the equivalent in EU is called ITS G5, and in Japan is the Arab standard for the same. So, for example, if you take the US standard. Here in the top left corner, we have the frequency allocation as such. So basically, they have 7-10 megahertz bands, of which the first one, channel 172 and 184, the last one, the ones in red, are the special ones. That's the one which is generally going to be used for your basic safety message and all those important critical messages. And the channel 178 is the control channel, and this will have the information regarding which service channels to look for and what information you'll get. So this like that. And the channels 174 174 176 180 182, these are not the safety critical ones, this channel. Yeah, this is the frequency allocation as such for the US. But recently in February 2020, FCC, they have proposed a newer version for the US, where the lower 45 megahertz of the channel, that is channel 172 to 178, they are trying to move to the unlicensed Wi-Fi band. And safety applications will have only the three channels, 180 to 184. This is a proposed one. So, because even in EU also it's 30 megahertz, maybe that's where they're getting aligned. And here, one thing what they want to do is they want to have one channel, channel 180, which will be for the DSRC or the CV2X for the car to car. And 182 and 184, they want to put the CV2X 20 megahertz. So that is for communication with the cloud. And if you see, the Phi and the Mac, as I told, DSRC is derived from the Wi-Fi. So the basic standard was 802.11a, and this is derived directly from that. If you see, what they have done is they have reduced the band, the bitrate by half. So from 6 to 3 and 54 to 27. So basically, they reduced the bitrate. They kept the modulation scheme, coding rate, number of subcarriers, etc., same. They have not changed that. But the symbol duration has been increased. In the 11A, used to have 4 microseconds for each symbol. Here it has been increased. And the cyclic prefix also is increased to 1.6 microseconds. So basically, if you can see through this information, 11P works at half the bandwidth, but it's like you have more time to do the same processing as such. And even the subcarrier spacing, if you see, it is now reduced to half. It is 156 kilohertz. Yeah, so Dalton, the next slide. Yeah, so that's from the 5 Mac part of it, how it looks like. And this is the standard protocol point of view, how does it look like? So if you see EU as well as US, you see the 5 and Mac is almost same. It's the based on the 802.11. So they both are the same. And the networking layer onwards, US and Europe gives it a bit different. And even the part of the Mac where they do the medium accessing. So here they have the 1609.4, which defines the multi-channel and the medium access, how it is done. And in the Europe, it is called a decentralized congestion control. So it's basically what it does is it tells when a transmitter can send the message. So the definition of that comes from here. The other one is if you see from the normal OSI layer, you have that IPv6 and TCP/UDP for networking and transport layers. So for the safety application, that is being changed, and you have something called wave short messaging protocol. So basically in this, what happens is in a UDP packet, the header itself is almost 52 bytes of data. So the thing what they done is they have reduced it to almost 11 bytes. They made the message size very short. So this is defined 1609.3. And the application layer, so there it's the definitions of how the messages should be for the basic safety messages. What is the format of data basically for each application is being defined in this. Similar in ITS G5, it's called cooperative assist messages and decentralized environment notification message. So these are basically what are the kind of messages a car can send to another car or the infrastructure. So that is defined in the top layer. And in this, if you see, this is basically an ad hoc network. It's not like our normal Wi-Fi where you require an access point. This doesn't require access point. Basically, a car will come in contact with another car only for a few minutes or something like that. So you don't have to set up a service set before communication. So that's the one. And this is of a very low latency. Yeah, on the next slide, we'll discuss on what the low latency means. Yeah. And as already discussed, the range is almost 2 kilometers with this 5 and Mac, and you have 360 degree view. The data rates, the maximum data rate supported is 27 Mbps, as we had said. And you have a signing of messages for the security part. The next slide. Yeah. So if you see what had been told was regarding the low latency being a critical in the communication between two cars. So in DSRC, the low latency is due to few things. First is that in a normal Wi-Fi, there is a time to set a service set creation. That time has been saved. So basically you don't have the frequency synchronization, authentication, association to an access point. So that has been removed. So that is not there. And in 802.11p, they have a new mode called outside the context of BSS. So basically here, what can be done is a station in OCB can send receive data before without any service set getting formed. So there for the initial, so you have time saved in the initial part. And the second one is the how do you access the channel. So the medium access here is carrier sends multiple access with collision avoidance. So in this case, what happens is a transmitter will send only when it knows the channel is free to send. So you don't have any collision, and there is no message to be repeatedly sent again, because we don't know whether previous message was collided or not. So that problem doesn't exist. So once it goes to the transmitter, then it's as fast it reaches the receiver. And the other part is the size of the messages, what I told before, wave short message protocol. So that is the other one which makes the message very short, and you can reduce the latency of a message sent from one car to another car. And here, what one more thing what they have done is like this is they have the channel. They are splitting it into 100 milliseconds duration, of which 50 milliseconds is for control channel, 50 milliseconds for service channel. This is for the US, this method. For the EU, they don't have similar scheme, but yeah. So in this, so any BSM message can be sent only in this 40 millisecond duration. That will be the, but since it is going to repeat every 100 millisecond, you can repeat the your, you can broadcast your GPS. Basically, you'll send your position, your speed, acceleration, this information you sent, broadcast it, and all the cars which receive it creates a environment. How does it look like depending on from all the messages it receives from other cars? Yeah, so these are the things which are used for low latency. The along with DSRC, I told there's a different standard which is coming, which is called cellular V2X. So this is nothing but based on a normal cellular LTE 4G, whatever we have now. If you see here, you have a link. If you, from cellular CV2X, right? You have on the left side, you call something called link. This is a traditional cellular connection. And they have something called PC5 RF link. That is called the side link. So in this side link, also now has two methods. One is it requires cellular base station, which is required for its time synchronicity. The mode 4 is direct communication without a cellular base station. And if you see, this mode 4 is the only one which is close to what DSRC is working. So in CV2X, we need more mode 4 messages to mimic the DSRC's performance. But still, it is not as fast as DSRC. The latency is almost 10 times. That's what our understanding is. If 10 milliseconds is the latency for DSRC, it's around 100 milliseconds for CV2X currently. But it'll improve the next standards which are coming. Yeah. And yeah, so as I told, so now once if you go to mode 4, for example, for the PC5 RF, one important thing is you require a GNSS, because it all the transmission is synchronous to a time slot, due to which that is mandatory now for a CV2X. In the mode 3 of PC5, there you don't require the GNSS, but the cellular base stations itself will give the time synchronicity. The only current issue is it is currently not supported by all the cellular base stations, PC5 mode 3. That is the only issue in this scheme. It's a upcoming scheme. Yeah. So next slide, Dalton. Yeah. So this is a short comparison between DSRC and the cellular CV2X. So if you see here, DSRC is based on the OFDM method, whereas that is based on the single carrier FDMA. And so basically what we know, SCFDMA is better for the low power amplifier, etc. So that is one advantage with that. The other one is the channel coding, right? So DSRC still uses the old convolutional channel encoder decoder, whereas LTE uses the turbo codes, and turbo codes has better performance. You can add more redundancy into the same bandwidth. Regarding time synchronization, this is one thing which has a big impact in the sense DSRC is asynchronous. So when a transmitter wants to send, it just checks whether the channel is not used, then it can send the data. Whereas in the CV2X, it is slot based. So it has to check for each slot. And in each slot, it has to check which of the resources are available. That is, which of the channel, which of subcarrier, and at which slot is available, that it should know that. And because of the synchronous operation, it is highly dependent on the GNSS clock. And it's very much required for reliable communication. And so problem here is if you enter tunnel, urban places and all, this has a problem because of the GNSS issue. Then the next one is the channel access. So here, as I told, it is CSMACA. Since it's collision avoidance, the transmitter, only one transmitter will be sending at a time in the DSRC. So there's no collision at all. Single user occupies the whole system bandwidth. Whereas in LTE V2X, it is semi-persistent scheduling. So basically here, what happens is, as I told you, each car should be checking which is the resource which it thinks is least used, and it'll try to send a packet. And due to which, there's possible chance of packet collision always. So because of this, you have the, so persistent packet collision problems are there. And similarly, causes high network congestion because you need to repeat the same message because you don't know whether the packet collided before or not. So by the standard itself, they have to keep on sending again and again. Now, if you see from the OFDM symbol point of view, right? For DSRC, the each symbol is only 8 microseconds. That's a very small symbol. Whereas for the CV2X is almost 71 microseconds. The other one is the subcarrier spacing is almost 10 times for the DSRC. The subcarrier spacing is 156 kilohertz, whereas in LTE, it's 15. So basically, the frequency error, right? Frequency between the oscillators of transmit receiver, how much it can vary, that will have a impact because of the subcarrier spacing. Yeah, and also what is told is the Doppler channel variations, so and synchronous errors, all these can happen. And speed limit currently they have is a 140 kilometers per hour, that is as per the 3GPP report. Then because of this symbol duration and the subcarrier spacing, right? You can really see this. The time accuracy is a plus minus 1000 microsecond, whereas in CV2X, it's very small, 0.39. So it has to be very close. And the frequency error, right? It can be 20 ppm. And on this is 0.1. So this also, it's in the implementation point of view, it is going to be the difficult LTE CV2X is going to be difficult. Basically, the oscillator should be perfectly matched for the CV2X. So that is one more only. Then what I told before, like the backport compatibility. If you see DSRC and the NGV, then the newer standard, both are compatible. They can coexist in the same channel. So without interfering with the previous DSRC. So 11P and 11BD, both we can exist in the same channel itself, and it is backward compatible. So the older cars, new cars, all can work seamlessly. But in CV2X, this is one problem. So if you go to release 16, the newer version, then those radios cannot talk to cars with 14, 15. Then you require a translator in between. And that is going to be another problem with that. And you can see from the infrastructure point of view, right? DSRC is only on the cars, right? That's an important thing. So these applications and everything around it is going to be is independent. And the state government should give the infrastructure for the infrastructure point of view. V2I alone they need to support. There's nothing from the government, support is not required for the car installation and But for the other one, CV2X, yeah, you need a commercial network owned by telecom service providers. So that's the other difference between DSRC and CV2X. Yeah. So Dalton, the next slide. Yeah. So now this was all regarding the modem and how the actual PHY and MAC is, and how the two competing standards look like. So Dalton, you can take over for security aspect.
Please unmute yourself, Dalton. You are not audible.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Okay. Sorry. So we discussed. Rajiv given rather detailed look into the heart of V2X system, which is the communication standard, right? So along with that, security is a major concern in a V2X system, and here my intention is only to give a peek into what are the topics or what are the challenges here, right? So yeah, again, we have cars communicating with each other. So the first question, if you receive a message from another car, is does the message really originate from that car, or did someone, a hacker, came in between and modified that message, right? It could be disastrous, I mean, if this happens. Then there is privacy, right? Your car keeps sending messages every now and then, I mean, continuously. Now, if someone knows your identity, that can be easily used to really track you, right? So if your system is not designed to protect your privacy, there's going to be serious implications. And there's also a problem of non-repudiation. So a sender sends you a message, and then later he says, no, I did not send it, right? So now we need a security architecture to address this type of problems, right? We typically don't need things like encryption because, for the messages, primarily because the messages sent are not really confidential. At the same time, primarily this authenticity, privacy, and non-repudiation are fundamental topics in a V2X system. So, I just wanted to introduce how we solve this problem. Right at the heart of it is digital signatures. So when a car tries to send a message to the next car, he signs it with his private key, right? So signing is some mathematical operation where the message and this key is used and to generate a next number. Right. Similarly, there is a verification mechanism provided in digital signatures where you can cross-check whether with a public key of the original sender, you can verify that the signature is correct or not. And if that matches, right, you absolutely know that the message came from this car and also it is not modified. So, so there are details like, what is the signature signing mechanism that we use? We use elliptical curve digital signature, so going a little faster, we also need to look at what is the degree of signing and or what is the rate at which we'll have to sign and verify. Right, because whenever you send a message to the next car or from you to anyone, you have to sign that message so that the recipient, all these small cars here, the recipients can verify it. So signing is actually a lower frequency event because you are sending, probably 10 messages per second or more. But signature verification is another activity where you get a lot of messages from all the cars around, and then you need to ensure that that is coming from an authenticated car, right? So that way the verification rate that you need is substantially high than the signing rate, and this is typically what you need to achieve in a system. And at the heart of the third problem that we discussed was the privacy, right? How do we ensure the privacy of your car, right? So the scheme is very simple. There is something called pseudonym certificates, wherein so whenever you send a message, you have to attach your identity, right? And so the system defines a means to frequently change this identity so that nobody can really track you. So don't go into the details here, but essentially, these are the three critical problems in the security of a V2X system. That's authenticity. We have digital signatures to address them. We have privacy problems. We define pseudonym certificates, a short-lived certificates for your identity. And then non-repudiation, which is again addressed with digital signatures. So I now move to the next topic. So far, what we did was we looked into what is V2X, what are the typical applications, what are the typical technical topics that needs to be addressed in engineering a V2X system. There we discussed the communication related protocols, so 802.11p, the Wi-Fi based, as well as CV2X. And then we also quickly looked into the security related problems. Essentially we do the digital signatures and signature verifications with the elliptical curve, etc. Now quickly to introduce the products, right? The NXP now in our latest generation, we introduce two V2X products. So just to run through, so security, the primitives that is used for different regions are different in security. So our current device support EU, US, Japan, and Korea. The modem chip, I'm sorry. So even for modem, we have different frequency ranges at different countries, right? Current NXP solution support these different frequencies. The standard is 11p. So typically, there are topics like functional safety that come into modern automotive solutions. I don't go into the details here, but it's a really hot term in our current domain, automotive domain. And probably if you're interested, try to read out. The signature verification we have implemented in our modem device, as well as communication between a modem and a microcontroller. We have different standards, like different interfaces like Ethernet and SDIO. I'm almost running out of time. So on the secure element also, an important topic that you should be aware is the certification of these devices. These are very sensitive devices. So we need to ensure that they are properly certified. Common criteria certification is done for our device, as well as FIPS, which is the US certification standard. We support different regions, the different standards. US deploys 609.2, whereas Europe uses HC 103.097, etc. So the idea behind that slides were to just introduce the key terms around these devices. Now we look at the overall deployment status, right? Start with Korea. Korea recently announced something called a Korean New Deal, it's a long-term vision for the economy and the post-COVID revival of the country. And one of the aspects they clearly defined in that was the CITS, the cooperative ITS, that's our V2X deployment in many cities. And they said 51.2% is targeted by 2022. So, this much of roads will have the infrastructure to communicate to cars. That's the Korea's target. China clearly moved to the cellular V2X. There's a little lack of clarity on how things are evolving there. So one of the interesting use cases people came up for this DSRC technologies, the toll, right? So Singapore is extensively working on a toll program, the electronic road pricing is it's called, which at the heart of it uses DSRC to achieve this. So it's not a road safety application there, but the toll collection mechanism. In EU, we have there are different car makers making the car. There is something called a Euro NCAP. It's a safety assessment program, right? And the highest star rating by 2024, people need to have a V2X in their cars. There is a lot of road rollout. As Rajiv mentioned, there is a challenge about the frequency allocation in US. So US, there is this discussion going on the actual allocation of this 75 megahertz available frequency. Now to summarize in timeline, a major car maker of Japan launched DSRC from 2015. Someone in US started in 2017, and we have Europe a major release in 2019. So there are specific car makers already deploying the DSRC in the field. At the same time, it's not a full-fledged or widely used technology yet. There are additional customers who already commit a DSRC in the next years. Along with that is the roads, right? Now cars having, so as we discussed, V2X means you need to have the capability in the cars as well as the road, the infrastructure. So there is a massive sea roads project in Europe, European Union. It is to have roads with the right infrastructure. The last number we saw is 6,000 kilometers of deployment by 2020. Austria, they also have extensively deploying the RSUs, the road infrastructure, and they are targeting by 22. As I discussed, the nationwide deployment of the toll booth stuff in Singapore, that's also coming up. So summary is there is some degree of traction. There is, all the major continents, there is some cars with the V2X already. At the same time, it's not yet a de facto standard or something that's widely used. That evolution is need to slowly happen. To close this discussion, for a student, for someone studying in the college, what do you do to get a better understanding about V2X? Right, we have a brief summary of the standards. Probably understanding the standards and having a look at it would be useful. So US has its own set of standards, Europe has its own set, and as well as security, there is another set of standards to be understood. Now, if someone is interested to really make their hands dirty, try to do something. We are aware of course, the commercial boards that's available with V2X modems, and you can do something, but there's nothing really visible, which is really cheap or which is easily accessible. In a similar way, we have seen some open source stacks with V2X. At the same time, we haven't really explored much to really recommend something there. So, but it's more of a exploration topic for you. So I wanted to conclude with the extension of V2X technologies into something more, this was an A2X communication. So this is again an input from Germany, right? They have this DLR, German Research Center for Aeronautics and Space. I guess it's a governmental agency. They were working on a project where helicopters, right? So one of the challenges in the system is helicopters, if they are in some rescue operation, they will have to land on the road. So, but if the road traffic is going on, how do you land there, right? There is a protocol now being worked out where the helicopter sends again the V2X messages to the cars to stop somewhere, right? So that it becomes safer for helicopters to land. So this type of interesting, innovative applications are coming up in the V2X domain. And so certainly this is going to expand more. And with, yeah, and the DSRC especially, I mean, it was standardized probably 10 years back. So with more than a decade, it's a mature technology ready to be deployed. And with more new applications coming, it's certainly going to be a game changer in the future. At the same time, there is this real competition between DSRC and CV2X for getting the acceptance in the V2X. So there's certain dynamics being played out, but yeah, we have to wait and see which technology really wins. Yeah, so that's all we had. So any questions, anything, how is it?
Yeah, everyone, all my young innovators, thanks for your time. And thanks, Dalton and Razeev. Thanks a lot for all your effort. In the short span of time, you basically, gone through each and every aspects of the V2X, which is very helpful for our audience. Mainly this audience is from the college. So maybe we have, few queries related to this. And I'm very hopeful that our students will try and will be, try hands-on exercises on this one. So, yeah, so my commitment from Rajiv and Dalton side, we will support you. You please try all these technologies, which is very helpful and futuristic and will be very helpful in your career also. So with that, thanks a lot, Dalton and Rajiv. You want to say something?
No, thanks, Manish. I mean, it was a real pleasure to prepare. I mean, we tried to prepare an overall broader picture about it a lot without a lot of details. But yeah, it was a pleasure to interact with the younger community. Certainly.
Yeah. Okay. Rajiv, anything from your side? You want to do some commitment for our students?
We are always there, so not a problem. Yeah.
Okay, one more query in the meantime. Recorded session, yes, session is recording. Recording is going on. Although this Q&A session will not be the part of the Q&A session, but so you can go through those recordings. Okay, with that, thanks a lot. Please take care and have a good day. Bye bye.
Thank you very much, Manish. Thank you, everyone. Bye.